The show, Cabinet Office Minister Michael Gove. Good morning to you. Good morning to you, Michael. Can you hear me?
Hi, good morning to you.
I know you've just escaped the clutches of Piers Morgan, so out of the frying pan into the fire, I fear for you. But on very different grounds. Can you tell me where in the 48-page assessment that was published by the government yesterday afternoon, in terms of the wider impacts on health and in the economy, they're provided any justification for the tier restrictions that are going to start tomorrow?
Well, the document I think was very clear. Firstly, it has been the case that the tier restrictions that we had before November were not enough in order to be able to ensure that the R rate, the infection rate, was brought down. The lockdown measures that we have in place have brought that infection rate down. Under the new tier three, we can be confident that infection rates will be reduced. Tier two is a way of effectively stabilizing and in some circumstances reducing infection. Tier one, not effective in reducing infections, but appropriate where infection rates are low. And overall, unless you bring the infection rate below one, then the number of infections will double over time, and that will lead to the overwhelming of the NHS.
Okay. You wrote an article in The Times, a very lengthy article, about how the lockdown had been the only way to stop the NHS being broken. There is no evidence that infections were, you know, doubling at the time that the lockdown was brought in. No evidence that the NHS was about to be overwhelmed. Still isn't any evidence. Even in terms of tier restrictions, you're saying not being enough. Actually, infection rates were falling in the tier three places like the hotspots, like Liverpool. Why do you base government policy on evidence which is not available, it would appear, to anyone who's looking at it, whether a member of the public or indeed the scientists looking at it from externally, given that it's not based on publicly available data?
Yes, it is. The ONS figures showed that the R rate was above one in every part of the United Kingdom.
It did not show that infections were doubling, and it did not show that the NHS was about to be overwhelmed. No public or private documents that I've seen since have suggested any of that was the case, but that was used to justify the lockdown, and you've justified the restrictions saying that the lockdown had brought it down and we need to carry this on. But there's never been any data that's actually been produced, not a model, but actual data of what's happening now on the ground on the day you make those decisions that justifies any of those moves.
Again, I'd refer you to the ONS figures that showed that the infection rate was doubling on average every 15 days in the 6 weeks up to the announcement of the November measures on the 31st of October.
It was going up at a slower rate. In large parts of the country, it was actually going down.
The R rate was above one in every region of the country. Mm-hmm. And of course, if the R rate is above one, sooner or later, the infection rate will double. The higher it is above one, the faster it's doubling. And of course, if the infection rate doubles, so the number of hospitalizations inevitably increase, with hospital capacity at the moment around 88%, there is some spare capacity in the system. But obviously, if you increase the number of COVID patients, then that means that other patients aren't being treated, and that means that health outcomes are worse.
OK, but it's not at a particularly unusual level of capacity at the moment than it is from any other year, and you know that as well as I do. The Times today have produced a...
The NHS faces significant pressure, you're right.
It does every
December,
year.
And particularly in January and in February. But what would overwhelm it would be the existence of a significant number of additional COVID cases. And it is the case that other countries, from Sweden to France to Canada, have taken similar measures in order to ensure that their health services aren't overwhelmed and their economies aren't damaged.
Michael, we didn't elect the government of Sweden or France. I thought one of the reasons why we voted for Brexit, which a campaign you were very strong on, was to take back control. We get to decide our own policies, don't we? We don't have to do what other countries do. The Times front page today...
But we can learn from them. I think one of the reasons for taking back control is, of course, being accountable. But the question that inevitably will be asked is, which country has an alternative model to the one that so many Western countries have chosen, which people think would be better? And of course, we can always refine the measures that we have. But the question is, what is your alternative? And I haven't seen a coherent one yet.
Oh, I think Sweden has provided a coherent one in terms of the lack of liberty taken away. But there we are. The Times today has produced a secret dossier.
In Sweden, Julia, there are restrictions.
There are very few restrictions. They're largely voluntary.
No, they're not. There are criminal sanctions. There are criminal sanctions for people who break those restrictions. No, and it's also the case that Sweden has a rising hospitalisation, rising death rate, which is why other restrictions tragically...
Death rate is a fraction of ours per capita at the current time.
It's increasing at the moment.
It's a fraction of ours per capita. Yes, with all due respect, it's December. Respiratory illnesses tend to go up in December. They do every single year. But can I get on to something else?
Death rates are going up in Sweden.
Death rates are going, yes. Do you want to tell me what the death rate is, what the number of people who are dying in Sweden right now is?
It's increasing rapidly. That's why they've got measures.
It's at tiny, tiny, tiny levels. But anyway,
it's significantly greater than all its neighbours. Significantly greater than Norway.
I'm not going to get sidelined onto this. There are lots of different reasons for that, and you will know those as well as I do. I want to talk about the Times front page today. Secret dossier on COVID damage. Yesterday we had this impact assessment at 48 pages, which contained the most extraordinary line I think I've ever read in supposedly a detailed assessment of what the economic impacts of COVID measures would be. It says any attempt to estimate specific economic impacts of precise changes to individual restrictions for a defined period of time would be subject to such wide uncertainty as to not be meaningful for precise policy making. Yet the government has used very imprecise and very uncertain SAGE modelling for the virus's impact. Modelling that, by the way, has been proven to be wrong again and again and again by a huge factor. And yet the Times today have got a secret dossier that the government has drawn up showing huge economic impact. Which is it? Has the government drawn up an economic impact assessment or hasn't it?
There are three things I'd say there. The first is that if we look at the modelling of the growth of the infection, that modelling has been pretty robust. On the second point, again, about the... Yes, and the second point, I was just talking about the ONS figures earlier, which showed the rates of doubling and which were in line with SPIME and other models from which scientists have had high confidence. Again, you didn't seem to have those ONS figures to hand. That's fair enough. On the second point about the economic impact, we know, everybody knows, the OBR reminded us of the dreadful economic impact of the pandemic, but it's the pandemic that's generating the economic impact. On the third thing, I think it is the case that the document which you refer, which I haven't read myself, is based on publicly available information from the ONS and other sources of statistics.
Okay. By the way, I do have those ONS figures to hand because it was 51,900 new infections between the 17th and the 23rd of October. It had fallen to 45,700 by the 25th to the 31st of October. 51,900 is a higher number than 45,700. It's definitely not a double that number, is it?
Well, the rates were doubling.
The rates were doubling, but you said I didn't have... I do have those figures to hand. You were quoting the ONS figures... The ONS figures show they were falling, not doubling.
They were doubling on average in every 15 days in the 6 weeks up to the announcement of the November measures on the 31st of October.
I'll have to agree to disagree. I mean, I'm just quoting the official ONS figures. I do apologise for that. And can I ask you about Nadeem Zahawi?
No, I don't make any apology for that.
Okay. Nadeem Zahawi is a vaccine minister, looking at the rollout. He's talked about how the vaccine won't be mandatory, won't be required. You're not going to be actually holding people down and forcing them to have the vaccine. I mean, that's something to be grateful for, I suppose. But that there may well be businesses, I mean, whether it's airlines or pubs or cinemas that say basically you can't come in unless you have got proof you've had a vaccine. Is that going to happen?
No, that's not the plan. Our plan is to make sure that we distribute the vaccine to all those who need it. And we want to make sure that, first of all, those people who are vulnerable, those who are older, those who are in care homes get vaccinated, and then also the frontline NHS and social care staff upon whom we depend, and then we want to spread the vaccine more widely thereafter.
Okay, and what is the timetable for that? Because I can understand we haven't got a vaccine, not one of these yet has been approved by the regulators. And the moment it is approved, we've already bought a lot of these supplies. Yeah. We've got millions already. I mean, again, all credit to the government on that, buying all these vaccines in advance, getting them manufactured, so when they're approved, we can roll them out. That is one of the big ticks. Well done. You get that from me. I'll give you credit when you get it right. However, I want to know you're welcome. I want to know what the actual timetable is, because please God tell me that the government has got a very clear outline and timetable for when these are going to be rolled out.
Yes, you're absolutely right. It's subject, of course, to clearance by the regulator. But provided we get that clearance, and of course the whole world is waiting for that clearance, then the first vaccinations should take place this month. and then we will increase the numbers in the new year.
By what date will everybody who is vulnerable or elderly have the vaccine, and by what date will everyone be able to have the vaccine? Because this is the stuff that government is paid to do, to plan and organise. So can you give me two? On any given day, let's say on the 1st of January, we get one of these vaccines approved. What date from the 1st of January will we have access to everybody who's elderly or vulnerable and everyone else to get that vaccine?
Well, the first thing is that we're going to have, provided they're approved by the regulator, millions of vaccines available in December. And so we will start
that program.
I was
being generous. I was saying 1st of
January.
What date?
I hope we'll get it by then. But it will be the case that we will progressively increase the number of people who are vaccinated through January to April. And I would hope that by April or May, that we would have universal coverage. But of course, what we're working on now is making sure that we can have that distribution mechanism, working with the NHS in order to ensure that everyone who needs a vaccine gets it.
OK, but you're saying by April or May. Originally, it was by Easter, and then it's April or May. I've heard ministers say we wouldn't have even all the most vulnerable vaccinated by that time. It seems to change depending on which minister I speak to. But there must be, surely, a clear rollout plan. You knew these vaccines were on the way. You know you've got the army ready to deploy on this. Surely you can actually do the logistics. How many sites do we need? How many people do we need? How many people can we push through in any given day, whether it's in a stadium? So you must have an actual date, not a hope, a date.
Well, the date depends on both the clearance for those vaccines and also the nature of the vaccine. So to take the Pfizer vaccine, there are 46 mass vaccination centres that we've identified. One of the reasons why mass vaccination centres are favoured is because of the cold chain storage pressures that mean that when you're dealing with that vaccine, it needs to be stored for most of its life at a particularly low temperature. You can distribute it outside those mass vaccination centres, but there is a limited time period during which you can visit those in care homes and others. Of course, if the Oxford vaccine, the AstraZeneca vaccine, receives its clearance, then it can be distributed both at lower cost and in a faster way. But what we can't do is anticipate exactly when both are going to come into play. So that's why we've got a system both of cold chain distribution for Pfizer, the 46 vaccine centres that I mentioned, and also NHS General Hospital hospitals being used in order to vaccinate their own staff and others.
I know I've got to let you go, but we've got you a little bit late because Piers Morgan does that to us. Just finally, I want to ask you, tier restrictions come into force tomorrow. Very likely, of course, the vote is going to go through even without the Labour voting for it and lots of rebels not voting for it. But can you explain to me, because I'm really struggling with why it's OK and safe for me to go to a pub and have a drink with a meal, whether it's a scotch egg or a full fish and chips or whatever, and that will make me safe. But if I have a drink without a meal in Tiju, then that will make me at risk. But I can drink at a cinema or a football stadium or a theatre when those are reopened without a meal. Can you explain to me how the virus knows whether I'm standing up, sitting down, or whether or not I've got a meal next to my drink?
It's about mingling and reducing that. So in other countries, which have also got similar restrictions, table service is a means of reducing the risk. So
what's that got to do with meals?
Well, if you're sat at the table eating the meal.
No, but what's the meal got to do with it? Have you been to a pub since they reopened on the 4th of July, Michael?
Yes, I
have. Have you been to a pub where you've been allowed to stand or go to the bar?
I saw several people standing and indeed going to the bar.
Where?
In the pub that I was in. I was myself
House
sitting
of
down. No. It was actually, I probably shouldn't name the pub because I didn't want to advertise it, but it was a pub in West Kensington, where I went with my son and others in order to have a substantial meal and to watch Chelsea.
But people are only allowed to be served in the pubs at the table. So why does the virus know that you're having a drink at the table or that you're having a drink and a lasagna at the table? How does the pub know? How does the virus know?
Because we know that table service, driven by the need to serve meals and to serve people at the table, is safer.
It's a requirement in law that you're served at the table. That's a requirement right now in pubs that are open. So what's it got to do with the meal?
It means that it is easier to ensure that we're policing table service appropriately.
We're going to basically close down hundreds of thousands of businesses for that, and that's the answer.
It is the case that the pandemic, as you quite rightly point out, causes economic damage. But the question always
is... The pandemic doesn't cause economic damage, Michael. Lockdown policy does.
Well, what would be the alternative to restrictions on the spread of the virus? Unless we have restrictions on the spread of the virus, then the number of people who will become infected and go into hospital will overwhelm the NHS, and that will cause real long-term economic damage. I haven't yet
seen... As opposed to the fake long-term economic damage being caused now?
Yeah.
Okay.
No.
Michael, I know I'm going to have to let you go because we're way over time and I know you've got other interviews to get to. Cabinet Office Minister Michael Gove.